And electoral votes. Senator Kamala Harris flies in from nearby Nevada.
I am here to thank you, Nevada.
President Trump from Nebraska, where last night he claimed economic recovery.
This election is a choice between the Trump super recovery, which is what we're having, or a Biden depression.
Polls are tight in Arizona and other battleground states. Joe Biden making a bid for red state Texas, a huge haul with 38 delegates.
Into Texas, and I think we're not only, we have a shot.
And Georgia. Bill Clinton was the last Democrat to win here.
We can do it here in Georgia. We win Georgia, we win everything.
President Trump trying to hold on to the trio of Midwest states he won from Democrats 4 years ago. Biden is leading in Wisconsin and Michigan.
We will win, you will win, Michigan will win, and America will win. You got to go and vote.
Coronavirus still the big issue. The White House chief of staff says it cannot be controlled.
We can and we will control this virus.
President Trump argues it's not that bad.
Barron Trump is a case. He has sniffles. He was sniffling. One Kleenex, that's all he needed. One, that was it. And he was better.
With surrogates hitting swing states.
Donald is a fighter.
Florida, we can't afford four more years of this.
Decision 2020 is a battle to the finish. In 6 days. Tracy Potts, NBC News.
President Trump's campaign website was briefly taken over by hackers. Channel 11's Jacqueline Fell explains what law enforcement officials say about these types of security threats.
The Trump campaign says this attack was short-lived, but cybersecurity experts tell me it could become common as we're just days away from the election. The Trump campaign tells us its website was seemingly taken over by hackers, threatening to release what they called classified information about the Trump administration. They posted that the world has had enough of the, quote, fake news spread by the president. The hackers also asked for money, posting details of a cryptocurrency account that's hard to trace. The Trump campaign manager said no data was stolen and that the website was back to normal in less than 30 minutes. Both presidential campaigns, as well as law enforcement and intelligence agencies, have been on high alert for this type of digital interference ahead of next week's election. Intelligence agencies have been closely monitoring overseas hacking groups, and that includes teams from Iran and Russia who they say have tried to influence the U.S. election in recent weeks. Reporting outside Washington, Jacqueline Fell, Channel 11 News.
The CEOs of Facebook, Twitter, and Google are being questioned by a Senate committee today. A virtual hearing is underway. Lawmakers looking at increasing big tech's transparency and accountability for content. They're also calling into question they are also questioning the CEOs on privacy. Some have criticized the Republican-led hearing just days before the election as an offensive against big tech. New at noon, another layoff announcement from Boeing. The company says it will cut 7,000 more jobs following a plunge in revenue. The aircraft maker had already announced it was cutting staff by 19,000 jobs earlier this year. In August, the company offered a new round of buyouts from workers. Also new at noon, the U.S. government will pay drug maker Eli Lilly $375 million to supply 300,000 doses of its experimental coronavirus antibody drug. The FDA will have to first authorize emergency use. The drug would be for people with mild to moderate COVID-19 symptoms. If the authorization is granted, there will be no out-of-pocket costs for patients, although medical centers could charge a fee. New developments in how Pittsburgh police are allowed to do their job. It was prompted by a bar brawl. Channel 11's Alyssa Raymond explains the changes.
Since the pandemic started, Pittsburgh police say that they haven't done anything undercover like they did back in October of 2018 here at Copey's. The next time they have to do one of those undercover details, though, there's going to be some new policies officers have to follow. This week, during a Citizen Police Review Board meeting, Pittsburgh Police Chief Scott Schubert and Assistant Chief Lavani Bickerstaff shared what the department has done since this incident caught on camera, showing four undercover detectives fighting with members of a motorcycle club during a nuisance bar operation. Video also shows the officers drinking before the fight. Now, here's a look at some of the policy changes. Officers are not allowed to have more than 2 alcoholic drinks in 4 hours. They're also not allowed to drive afterwards.
Everything we do is, you know, the community and the police. It's not one or the other. So it's something I take very seriously, is maintaining that level of trust and just trying to be as transparent as I can. And we're not perfect. We do make mistakes. And when we make those mistakes, looking at the best way to fix it.
There's another change that the Pittsburgh Police Department is looking into that involves officers and alcohol. We're going to take a look at that at 5. Reporting on the South Side, Alyssa Raymond, Channel 11 News.
Those officers were placed on leave but reinstated. Charges never stuck against the officers or the bikers. Lawsuits are still moving through the court system. He left his home last Friday, and he hasn't been heard from since. The message a local woman needs everyone to hear as she looks for her husband. And the new steps Pitt is taking to keep students and staffers healthy as its number of COVID-19 cases continues to rise.
We're just worried. We're scared for him.
State police in Butler are searching for the man you see on your screen. Sean Kelly is a guidance counselor at Carn City High School. Channel 11's Jillian Hartman spoke with his wife. She says her husband was supposed to have surgery in Cleveland on Monday, but he never showed up and he hasn't been heard from since.
It's been too long that he has been gone. You know, we're just worried. We're scared for him.
45-year-old Sean Kelly, a guidance counselor at Carn City High School, is still missing. His wife, Rachel, is trying to get the word out and shared these photos of the two of them together.
He's just one of those guys. He would just do anything for anybody. I have never met anybody who, you know, just doesn't like him.
She also says he loves riding horses and motorcycles. However, no one has seen or heard from her husband since he left their house in his black Ford Fusion Friday night.
We're just worried. We're scared for him. you know, not knowing where he is and if he is okay.
She reported her husband missing on Saturday and has been working with state police ever since to find him. There's urgency to locate Kelly because of his medical condition.
My husband has Crohn's disease, and he was scheduled to have surgery at the Cleveland Clinic yesterday. He was to go Saturday for a COVID test in Cleveland. He didn't show up for his test, and he didn't show up for surgery. So that is also concerning to us.
She says his phone is turned off, but police were able to determine that it was last turned on Sunday morning in North Washington, Butler County, near the fire department. State Trooper Josh Black says they were out in that area again searching for Kelly. Folks on social media are doing their part. Rachel's post about her husband's disappearance has been shared nearly 2,000 times.
My son and I are just overwhelmed by it. You know, it's just amazing.
Jillian Hartman, Channel 11 News.
And if you have any information about Sean Kelly's whereabouts, please contact State Police in Butler. The number is 724-284-8100. We also have the number for you on our website at WPXI.com. Today, students in our region's biggest school district could find out if they are going back to school in person. The Pittsburgh Public School Board will vote on a plan to move to a hybrid model November 9th. Students would alternate going to school in person 2 days a week and learning at home 3 days a week. We're getting new COVID-19 numbers from the University of Pittsburgh, and since Thursday, there have been 21 new cases, 17 students and 4 employees. This is the third report issued since the university transitioned to a guarded risk approach. And the presidents of both the Student Government Board and the University Senate said they are very concerned about that decision. Meanwhile, Pitt is asking students to shelter in place ahead of the Thanksgiving break. The move starts on November 12th. The order includes 10 days on campus and at least 4 days sheltering in place once they return home. Students will then finish the semester virtually. West Mifflin High School will be shutting its doors for the next 10 days. 3 staff members there tested positive for COVID, and several teachers are in quarantine. Students will be participating in virtual learning. All other schools in the district will continue in the hybrid model until further notice. Chartier's Houston Junior Senior High School is also closed after 2 students there tested positive. The school is expected to reopen Thursday. Students will learn virtually until then. Students at Allison Park Elementary will continue to follow their hybrid schedule. The Greater Latrobe School District is taking a step back. It's going to be returning to full-time remote instruction for all students beginning on Monday. A letter sent to parents cites the recent surge of cases in Westmoreland County. Greater Latrobe reported 5 active cases within the district and 44 inactive cases.
For severe weather, Team 11 forecast.
It's been a very dreary and gloomy day, and you can tell just by looking outside, live perspective now from our tower cam. This is what it looks like in Pittsburgh. Can barely see the buildings in the horizon. That's due to visibility issues due to fog. So right now, 6-mile visibility in Pittsburgh, even denser fog off toward the east, including in Greensburg. 2.5-mile visibility. So that's what we're tracking, along with a few leftover showers from this morning. And I do mean a few. It's just some light rain and some drizzle out there. For everyone else, you're dry but overcast skies, and that will continue for the rest of the day. But the rain, that will continue to dry out. Some light rain right now around Pittsburgh, around Beaver, north of Washington. Just a few spots there in Westmoreland County and a few spots there close to Uniontown. And that's pretty much about it. We'll be dealing with some light rain lingering on for the next hour around 4 o'clock. If you're headed out and about, expect conditions to be dry. Again, still overcast, still very cloudy, still very gloomy. Temperatures for this afternoon and even as we go into the evening hours, remaining in the 50s. Highs today peaking into the mid to upper 50s, around 56 degrees. So overall, a very cool day. Those isolated showers will continue again for the next hour, and then we dry out before we see the soaking widespread rain that we're going to get on Thursday. Coming up in the next half hour, I will show you the hour by hour storm tracker to let you know when that soaking rain moves in and when it moves out. But it will all be due to Hurricane Zeta. You already see all of the rain is producing for the southern states, especially the coast of Louisiana. It will approach the coast of Louisiana right now at a category one strength, moving north at 18 miles per hour, making landfall somewhere in the southeastern coast of Louisiana. And as it moves in, it will, of course, continue to weaken, still producing a whole lot of rain. And notice it moved toward us. And as it moves toward us, it will increase our rain chances from the south toward the north throughout the day tomorrow. So the remnants of Zeta, that's where we're getting our rain from. And we're going to get a lot of it. Just look at the rainfall totals really add up as we go throughout Thursday into the rest of this week. So we could see near 1 inch, near 2 inch, and even some model projections have around 2.5 inches and even up to 3 inches. It will be something to watch. We definitely need the rain. We're going to get a lot of it. Again, widespread rain, steady rain at times, and even heavy rain in a few spots for your Thursday. Now, any flooding issues should be isolated. We're going to continue to keep you updated here with the severe weather team 11, and going into your Friday, drying out nicely. Dry day on Saturday, and for your Sunday, a few leftover showers, a few afternoon showers rather, and temperatures will be in the 50s for this weekend.
All right, thank you. More than 500 firefighters are on the scene of a large wildfire burning in Southern California. The so-called Silverado fire broke out Monday morning. High winds caused that fire to spread quickly to more than 7,200 acres. More than 90,000 people had to evacuate. As of this afternoon, that fire is 0% contained. At a top there. Hit while they are already down, a new scheme that targets folks who are unemployed. And there's over $1 billion sitting in Harrisburg just waiting to be spent. Who could lose out if lawmakers don't come up with a plan for that money soon? clock is ticking on Pennsylvania's $1.3 billion in unspent federal coronavirus emergency money. If Harrisburg lawmakers don't act, Allegheny County could miss out on its share. This is the last portion of coronavirus aid that Pennsylvania got from the federal government early in the pandemic. Lawmakers have until December 1st to make a plan for the money. If they don't, it will automatically go to 60 of Pennsylvania's 67 counties. Allegheny County is one of seven counties that would not get the money because it already received some money directly from the federal government. We are learning more about how the Susan G. Komen Foundation plans to fight breast cancer. You might remember we told you that foundation plans to close all of its local offices around the country, including here in Pittsburgh. They're going to distribute the remaining money to five nonprofit organizations dedicated to breast cancer education, screening, and treatment. The foundation is closing the local branches by the end of the year. There is still no word on what will happen to big events like the Race for the Cure. For years, dogs have been sniffing out drugs and explosives at airports, but that's not all what researchers say these canines can also detect. And an election hoax preying on people of color that lies officials say the lies, excuse me, that officials say two men were trying to spread. Two conservative operatives are in trouble. They're accused of orchestrating tens of thousands of robocalls that are spreading false information. According to court documents, the calls were made to Midwestern cities with mostly black populations. Authorities say some of the calls were made to people here in Pennsylvania. The calls warned that information on mail-in ballots could lead to arrests or forced vaccinations. Officials say none of that is true. And yesterday, a grand jury in Cleveland indicted the men on multiple counts of bribery and voter intimidation. So by this time next week, most of your votes should be in the process of getting counted. But with the clock ticking, there is some confusion now. President Donald Trump is encouraging early voters to change their votes, so much so that Change My Vote was trending on Google and Twitter. But the question is, can you really do that? Channel 11's Gabriella DeLuca clears up the confusion.
If you've been on social media the past few days, you may have seen this hashtag trending, hashtag change my vote, implying that you've already voted and you want to vote for another candidate. We talked to officials who say you're just not allowed to do that.
If your vote has already been submitted, then that is the vote that will be counted.
That's the message county and state elections officials want to get across to anyone who thinks that you can change your vote after voting early. You can't. Not in Pennsylvania anyway.
Unless there's like an error like we talked about before, where you're missing signature and that kind of thing. But if you just want to change your mind, you've already cast your ballot, it's considered final.
The hashtag change my vote has popped up on social media over the last few days. Even President Trump jumping on board, sending a tweet saying change my vote is trending after the last debate.
Next person step forward.
He says the answer is yes in most states. Not so for our state. It's something he also encouraged back in 2016.
If you go in to your polling place on election day, they're going to say, sorry, you already voted by mail. And when you say, I want to change my vote, they're going to say, you can't do that.
Voters who were lined up downtown said the misinformation is disconcerting.
Our political climate itself is already very worrisome. You hear a bunch of different things. It was definitely like more misinformation than normal, for sure.
Which could cause confusion for Pennsylvania voters.
If you have already voted, technically you can go to your polling place and request a provisional ballot, but don't be fooled. It will not be counted because you've already voted.
When they go through your provisional ballot, they're going to check to see if you have already voted via any other method. And once they see that they already received a mail-in ballot from you, that provisional vote will never be counted.
So if you've already voted but changed your mind, you're out of luck. Gabriella DeLuca, Channel 11 News.
YouTube has a plan to block fake election news. Starting election day, they will add a special tab to videos for election-related searches. If you click on the tab, it will send you to trusted sources with real-time results. Severe weather team 11 meteorologist Jessica Faith joins us again. And Jessica, we could see the effects of Hurricane Zeta within the next 24 hours.
Yes, and the rain will be coming quite early. So we're trending drier as we head later into the afternoon hours. Right now, some remaining light rain and drizzle, spotty in nature, most of the area dry. Enjoy the drier conditions for the rest of this afternoon and this evening because that rain comes overnight. And coming up in about 15 minutes, I will show you the storm tracker and show you how that rain will move into our area and when it will move out. Temperatures right now on the cooler side. If you're going out for lunch in Pittsburgh, 49, 46 in Butler, 50 for Greensburg and for Beaver. Again, more details about Hurricane Zeta and the effects we have here in our neighborhood coming up in about 15 minutes.
Medicare plans to make any coronavirus vaccine free for senior citizens. That's according to senior Trump administration officials. The administration hasn't explained how that will work, but officials have said that they do expect vaccines will first go to people who are considered high risk. That includes medical personnel, senior citizens, frontline workers, and nursing home residents and staff. Numerous vaccine trials are going on right now. It could be next year, though, before a vaccine is widely available. The majority of Americans say they know someone who's been diagnosed with COVID-19. It is new data from the NBC News Survey Monkey Weekly Tracking Poll. It found 68% of adults know someone who had COVID, I do, and 34% say either themselves or someone in their home has been tested in just the last month. New at noon, sniffer dogs are a regular sight at airports around the world. They're used to sniff out a range of things, from drugs to explosives and more. But can they sniff out the coronavirus? Leaders of a trial program in Finland say, yes, they can. They claim they are nearing a 100% sensitivity rate, with the dogs able to detect the virus 5 days before humans even show any symptoms. NBC's Kelly Kobiea reports from Helsinki.
They say a dog's nose knows. And at a makeshift lab in Finland's Helsinki airport, researchers from the University of Helsinki are collecting sweaty samples from thousands of arriving passengers to show a dog's nose knows COVID-19, even better than man's best test.
They're, what, cheaper?
Yep.
They're quicker?
Yep.
Possibly as accurate?
Possibly even more accurate.
Because they can smell COVID days before a patient develops symptoms.
That, you know, really soft thing you have on your carpet at home, or, you know, that starts barking and wants to have food and go out, that this is actually a super accurate machine.
Here in Helsinki, they're screening passengers like me after baggage claim. A quick wipe down, hand over your tissues, and the dog goes to work behind a screen, scratching a positive control sample.
Well, that was quick.
But mine?
Negative.
As a backup, a free standard test at the airport with that eye-watering nasal swab, and results in a day or two by text. The dogs take a few days to a few weeks to train, depending on their background and their love of treats. And researchers say one dog can sniff more than 100 samples a day at airports, offices, nursing homes.
I mean, this could save lives.
This can save lives, actually, totally. So I think it was kind of a no-brainer for us.
Researchers here are now continuing with the trial over the next several weeks, trying to gather as much data as they can so they can prove in a strong scientific study that this actually works. But they're very bullish about it and say we could see these COVID-sniffing dogs at airports really around the world by next year. Kelly Kobiea, NBC News, Helsinki, Finland.
That is so interesting. Pope Francis continues to refuse to wear a mask, even though not wearing one means he has to keep his distance from the faithful. A Vatican official acknowledged the Pope is at risk of getting seriously ill if he catches COVID-19. He is, after all, 83 years old and had part of his lung removed as a child. Pope Francis has only been seen wearing a mask in public twice. The Vatican has not responded to questions about why Francis won't wear a mask or why Vatican protocol officials allow people to get close to him without donning their masks. A busted what police say they found going on at a Southside bar that forced them to close. Police raided an illegal speakeasy on Pittsburgh's South Side Slopes. According to the Trib, the nuisance bar task force executed a search warrant at Bridges last Friday on Arlington Avenue. Police found more than 60 liters of liquor, illegal gambling machines, cash, and 10 gallons of beer. Three people will be charged. The casino industry is asking for help from the government as it tries to survive the pandemic. Industry leaders say they need tax and regulation relief. The head of the gambling industry's national trade group says the pandemic cost states more than $2 billion in lost tax revenue while casinos were shut down for 4 months. 90% of casinos have reopened, but they are operating at restricted levels, and that includes the Rivers Casino in Pittsburgh. UPS is hosting a one-day hiring blitz. They're calling it Brown Friday. The company is looking for part-time seasonal workers. The company is looking to hire more than 800 new employees in the Pittsburgh area. They'll be working out of the North Shore and the New Stanton facilities. The hiring blitz is this Friday. The pandemic is already affecting Thanksgiving. Why you might want to start planning not to make sure that you have everything you want on your dinner table.
Hurricane Zeta will bring us soaking rain as we head into tomorrow. I'm looking at the latest storm tracker. It will time out when we'll see the bulk of the rainfall and tell you how much rain we're going to get.
Thanksgiving sure will be different this year for many families. Though the holiday is more than a month away, you might want to get a jump start on your planning. NBC's Liz McLaughlin explains.
In the wake of a pandemic, many Americans will be downsizing Thanksgiving traditions.
Normally it's a lot of family stuff, but not this year.
Smaller gatherings that may increase the demand for smaller turkeys.
What that means is they may not be as available, as readily available, and people will have to settle for a larger turkey, so there'll be more leftovers.
And after store shelves emptied in the early days of the outbreak, many grocers are stocking up on popular Turkey Day supplies to avoid shortages.
The supply chain really is driven both by the demand and the availability of the products.
Sales for online groceries and delivery services have been on the rise this year, and Thanksgiving will be no exception.
We have seen an increase in demand.
CrowdCow is already seeing a spike in sales for its delivery service that sources meat from independent farms, offering pasture-raised birds shipped straight to your doorstep.
The turkey ships starting on November 8th, so it's important to get your order in before that date.
For many, holiday shopping is as much a part of Thanksgiving as the turkey, but there will be far fewer in-store sales this year.
We usually have a family tradition where, you know, we go out on Thanksgiving night and then go shopping the next day, so it's going to be different shopping online.
Some Black Friday sales are already underway online, as retailers hope to spread out demand and avoid a holiday shipping backlog. Liz McLaughlin, NBC News.
With the expected boom in online shopping this holiday season, this is probably a good time to talk about safeguarding your accounts. 71% of holiday shoppers plan to do most of their shopping online this year. A new report by Bankrate found 91% have put their personal data at risk. Could be from things like reusing or saving passwords. Perhaps the most risky is saving payment information on a computer or a phone. Experts say change up your passwords and don't save that payment information. A new phishing scheme in Pennsylvania is targeting people who are looking for unemployment benefits, and this warning comes from the Labor Department. It says callers are posing as department staffers. They're asking for personal information to fix issues with your account. The Labor Secretary says, though, they will never call, text, or email you to investigate a fraud case. Last month, a surge in scams forced the department to put a three-week hold on new payouts. Bayer plans to build a new distribution center in Saxonburg-Butler County. The company is in talks for a 10-year lease. The site will support its radiology business, which has seen a lot of growth. Be careful how you throw away your disposable face masks. Some apparently are ending up in our oceans and harming sea life. This public service announcement comes from the Belgium Marine Environment Agency. It says it will take 450 years for masks to decompose. Scientists say some sea life thinks the masks are jellyfish and eat them. Fish and other animals can also get tangled in the masks. They recommend switching to a reusable mask.
Your severe winter Teen 11 forecast.
We're going to continue to fade rain chances as we go throughout the rest of the day. Even in the past 2 hours, we've decreased coverage greatly. And this is what we're left with right now as we wrap up this hour heading into the next. Just a few light specks on the radar, just some drizzles, a few light showers. And we're going to continue to dry out for the rest of this afternoon. So again, trending drier, also pretty cool this afternoon. Overcast skies, a high of 56 degrees. Dropping temperatures into the 40s, around 45. Cloudy, cool, and showers reemerging, pushing from the south toward the north as the remnants of Zeta move toward the north, moving our way, increasing our rain chances. So here's tonight around 10 o'clock. We're looking dry. Notice those green dots at the bottom. That's the rain that will move into our area into the nighttime hours. If you're headed out early, let's say around 5 o'clock, expect some rain, especially if you're off toward the south of Pittsburgh. But by sunrise, sometime after sunrise, really filling up our landscape. And then as we go later into the day, into the late morning hours, even heavier downpours possible. And then by this point, everyone is seeing rain. So getting in on that widespread soaking rain throughout the day. Now coverage looks to decrease slightly going into the nighttime hours. Still many spots of heavy showers, calling it numerous showers. Not really a heavy rain, but looking at a good bit of rain for our area. We're going to continue to decrease those showers into your Friday morning. So overnight, into the morning hours on Friday. We're looking much drier, maybe just a few showers lingering, but Friday will be a much better day with a better rain chance early into the day on Friday, right before sunrise. So how much rain could we get? The highest rain totals will be toward the south because that's where the rain is coming from as Zeta continues to track toward the north and east. So off toward the north, 1 to 2 inches, really north of Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh and the point southward could get in on around 2 to 3 inches of rain. And again, we do need the rain, but we're getting a lot of it pretty fast in 1 day's period. We're also trending cooler. So today's highs already on the cool side into the 50s, 56, into the 40s for tomorrow, 49, even cooler by Friday. A southerly flow brings us back into the lower 50s for Saturday. And just to give you a heads up, we are tracking a cold front moving through on Saturday, which could give us possible flakes. So again, this forecast is evolving. Just want to give you a sneak peek of what we're tracking. Continue to check in with us for the latest as we continue to fine-tune the details going into your Sunday and Monday. But for this 5-day forecast, the bulk of the precipitation comes on Thursday. Have your rain gear ready, drying out for the end of the week, and more showers possible for Sunday this weekend. Overall looking nice with highs in the lower 50s.
The Los Angeles Dodgers are the MLB champs for the first time in over 30 years. They beat the Tampa Bay Rays in Game 6. LA sports fans sure have had a lot to celebrate this month. The Lakers won the NBA championship just 2 weeks ago. Coincidentally, the Dodgers and Lakers also both won their league's titles in 1988. Fans got rowdy after the win, though. People set fires, they spray-painted buildings, some looted businesses. They also broke out the rear window and painted graffiti on a police car. Police declared an unlawful assembly. They ordered the crowd to disperse. A number of revelers were arrested.
The school is behind him. All of our friends and family are behind him.
A young man is going for it all, the title he is in the running for. And here's Local Steals and Deals' Lisa Robertson.
Today I have what can give you professional results at home with your makeup and your skin looking amazing. This line called Amazing Cosmetics is now a staple in professional makeup artist kits all over the world. And the reason is great looking skin. It all starts with great looking skin, but great looking skin requires a number of steps. Color correctors, do you use those? Now you can, because it's all 40% off. Then there's beautiful concealers and different concealers for different needs, right? This is a foundation that's fabulous because it's not going to be too heavy. So I was using this today, and I love the fact that it's not gloppy, right? It doesn't look like a mask on my face. So many beautiful things to choose from, and it's all 40% off on localsteals.com. If you're sitting at home looking in the mirror going, man, I wish my skin looked better. Really great makeup used by professionals is the way to get professional results, and I know you're going to love it.
Forget America's Next Top Model. A Midwestern kid is competing for America's Next Top Mullet. Meet 12-year-old Noah Smith. He's quite proud of his magnificent mane. So proud, in fact, that he's entered a competition for the best kids mullet in the country. So what motivated Noah's reach for greatness?
My mom just told me, you're going to be in this competition. And I said, okay.
If his hairdo is judged to be the best, he will also take home $500. Cute kid. 1 year ago today, we were in shock after video started coming into the newsroom showing a major roadblock. Check it out. Remember this? How could you forget? A Port Authority bus swallowed by a giant sinkhole on 10th Street downtown. It ended up spawning Christmas ornaments, T-shirts, and other keepsakes. Well, 10th Street just reopened a few weeks ago. It took so long to make repairs because of all the utilities that run under 10th. Repairs set the city back about $400,000, and the Pittsburgh Sewer and Water Authority spent more than $1 million. That's all for Channel 11 News at noon. Our next newscast is tonight at 5. Meanwhile, you can get breaking news updates anytime on our streaming apps. Have a wonderful day, everyone.